train stop was to go to a nursing home in Wakefield. And I knew the owner, and when I walked in, everybody made such a big deal out of me. They were dragging me around the room, saying the senator's here, come and meet Richard. And I don't know what happened. I started to get a little bit of a big head, you know, a little too self-assured. And I saw a woman, and she was sitting on the couch all by herself, and she was watching TV. So here I go right up to her, I felt my hand, I said, "Do you know who I am?" And she looked up at me and said, "I'm sorry, son, but if you go to the front desk, I'm sure somebody can tell you." I was like, this is going to be a long campaign. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. The people in this room really represent the leadership of the business community in the North Shore. And just having a couple of minutes to introduce myself to you and just let you know what I'm all about, background-wise, and what I want to do as the congressman from this district, I really appreciate the opportunity. As was mentioned, well, I guess the first thing is you pronounce my last name Tisei, very important. Nobody says it right, I always have trouble with it. I get the ethnic vote, though, from a lot of different people. A lot of people think I'm Oriental until they meet me, but my mother's maiden name is Razzaboni, which would never fit on a lapel sticker. And I have been in the legislature. I was in the legislature for quite a while. I was a state representative for 6 years, a state senator for 20, and I served as the minority leader in the state senate my last 4 years. And it's funny, when I go to Washington, I tell people I was the minority leader in the Massachusetts Senate. It sounds very impressive, but there were only 5 of us out of 40, so, but I do end up recovering. I tell them Scott Brown was one of my members, and you know, he's a rock star down there right now. So, but I do have experience in government, but I also have experience as well in the private sector, and that's really what shaped me as a person and shaped the way I look at things. I own a real estate company, Northrop Realtors in Winfield. We're 60 years old. I have 25 agents who work in my office. And really going through, you know, I worked there 18 years, I've owned it for 12, and really, you know, going through what I go through in that office, you really get a good indication of what's going on, you know, in the community and what's going on with individuals on a very personal basis. I think most people here recognize that when you're in real estate, when you're called in to look at a house, the first thing you want to do is find out what people's motivations are, you know, why they're moving. My job in my office is to, you know, go with agents when we get called and, you know, sit there and try to get the listing. But I've sat around a lot of kitchen tables the last 4 or 5 years and talked to people about what's going on in their lives. And a lot of people will say to me, "You know what, Richard, I don't want to sell my home, but, you know, I just lost my job. I'm underemployed. I can't afford to live here anymore." Then you deal with a lot of seniors, people who are getting ready to retire. Their home is their biggest asset. And you sit there and, you know, you have to tell them that their home is worth a third less than they thought it was. And all of a sudden you can see the wheels turning, you know, in their head, and they're recognizing that their whole retirement is going to be different, and lifestyle is going to be different than they had planned on for an awfully long time. And then, you know, in a town like Winfield, we never knew what a short sale was 5 years ago, or we never dealt with foreclosures. About 25% of all of the sales in Winfield, which again is considered an affluent community, were either short sales or foreclosures last year. So I get it. I understand what's going on in the economy and some of the things that people are dealing with every day. And, you know, I would say you really do see, I do think there's a big disconnect right now between, you know, what's going on in people's lives and what's going on in Washington, D.C. And rather than the government, you know, helping things along and helping revive the economy and get things going again, I think the government in a lot of cases is, you know, an impediment right now towards getting us back on track. And that's really the reason I wanted to, you know, you have to be a little crazy to run for public office, but that's the reason I wanted to get involved in this race, and because I do think I can offer the people of this district a pretty different perspective and a pretty clear choice in November. I'm talking about really 3 issues. You know, obviously getting the economy jump-started. That's the most important thing. It's on everybody's mind. I can tell you, you know, generally speaking, that, you know, what we're going through right now, a lot of people are describing this is the new normal, get used to it, you know. But I do think that if you look at things historically, you'll see that you know, since the Great Depression, if you take all the recessions together, and they all averaged out to about 10 months apiece. The longest lasted 16 months, but we're really right now in the 43rd or 44th month. Right? They say the recession's over, but it really isn't. I mean, if you talk to most folks right now, and usually after a recession, the economy jump starts and it comes back strong. And you don't see that happening here at all. And it's all about job creation. And most businessmen I talk to, I've been everywhere in this district, small business, medium, large. And when you go in and you talk to business owners, they all say the same thing. You know, basically, I'm not doing anything right now. You know, I'm going to wait. I don't know if there's an accountant in the room, but usually it like functions, I'll try to say, is there an accountant in the room? Somebody will raise their hand and I'll say, what are you telling your clients right now? And they all say the same thing, hold off, don't do anything right now. And part of it, I do think, is because of our tax policy. And nobody knows what our tax policy is going to be in January. And we have some parts of our tax policy, like the corporate tax rate now highest in the world, that puts American companies at a disadvantage. There are obviously a lot of problems with our tax code right now, and that needs to be a change with some type of comprehensive tax reform. Regulatory policy, and you know, I do view, I see my little world in real estate, how regulations affect what's, you know, how regulations generally affect the economy. I'd say, you know, doing new appraisal regulations that went into effect last year that make it harder for individuals to sell their homes. There are new lending regulations. You used to be able to just have a pulse and walk into a bank and get a mortgage. Now, a lot of people who are creditworthy, particularly if you're an independent contractor or a small business owner, it's really difficult to get financing right now. And then I know that a lot of the mortgage folks right now are really concerned about some of the new regulations that are really going to constrain what they're able to do in business. And that's just my little world in real estate. You talk to a lot of people in the healthcare industry, and they say, you know what, with this Obamacare, two regulations that are going to be written after the election over the next few years. So a lot of people are holding back. They want to see how those are all going to shake out. We talked to a lot of people in the financial service sector. You have Dodd-Frank with a couple of hundred regulations that are going to be written over the next couple of years. You know, people holding back in that case. So it isn't really, you know, when you look at what's going on across the economy, it isn't any wonder that people don't want to, you know, take a risk. You know, because most businesses, when I deal with my business, you know, I'm doing a two-year plan, a two- or three-year plan down the road. So people like to know what the rules are going to be, what the tax rate's going to be, and want some predictability. And we don't have that right now. And it's a big problem.